They're still here.
Yes, they're still here. It's an enormous honor for me to sit here with Fadi Gandour. He is just the best entrepreneur you can find. For a long time, he was the only one in the Middle East. He has built billion-dollar companies. He runs a VC firm right now. He has built hospitals for those in need. He's just an amazing personality. And I don't think startup people can get any better advice than all the stuff you've learned, Fadi, during your years.
Thank you, Martin.
Welcome.
Thank you.
Welcome.
Thank you. It's an honor. Thank you. Thank you.
So we go straight to the point.
Yes.
When you meet a lot of startup CEOs,
yes.
What's the most common advice you end up giving them?
So, I mean, being an investor and an angel investor and a builder of companies, I've realized over the years that it is never about you alone. So you need to always, I need to always see the team. It's about the team. Who works with you? Who's your co-founder? How do you build teams? How do you attract talent? How do you get people to stay around with you and work with you and believe that there is a future for them where their ambition can happen, where they can actually create and generate their own wealth? So the core story is always about, you know, everybody is going to come and say, I'm building a product, I'm doing this, I'm doing that, good stuff.
Yeah.
But what is going to differentiate you for me and what advice I'm going to give you is, how do you build that organization that is going to last? And you do that with people at the end of the day. I mean, they're the ones that are going to differentiate your capabilities down the sustainability road of that startup.
Right. So when you, if it is about the team, when you meet the CEO, how do you know whether the CEO can build
and
a team?
And you know, you're going to be poking, you're going to be asking questions, you're going to be saying, you know, so who's, how is it that you're going to share your ideas? Who advises you? How do you go out and recruit these guys? What do you give them? How do you entice them to stick around? Do you think about these things? I mean, if they're not thinking about these things, they, you can tell very quickly. I mean, for those of us who build businesses, it is very easy to catch the guy that is a salesman rather than, well, with all due respect to salespeople, I love salespeople, or the guy that actually means what he is saying.
Right. So does a leader have to be extremely tough, or do they have to be extremely soft? Or
no, soft. I look, you need to have a balancing act at all times. So tough, you need to be tough when you need to be tough.
Yeah.
And you need to be soft in the sense of absorbing and advising and acting as addressing the challenge from a learning perspective rather than really being soft and not taking any issue or challenge or a problem in the organization without making it a lesson. I mean, that
right.
You know, we learn by continuously making mistakes. So it's not about softness. It's about what do we do with that.
Yeah. So then, if you look at an entrepreneur, does it matter what education they have? Is there some education that's especially good or especially bad?
Well, you know,
bad?
If you're technical, then you're technical. You have to have that.
Yeah.
You have to know your stuff. But I'm not going to ask you if you have an MBA or... or what did you study?
So I mean, MBA, that's an interesting, is that a positive or negative?
I'm neutral on it, okay?
Right.
It doesn't matter. Who cares if you have an MBA or not? It's about your knowledge and your passion and your ability to actually articulate what you want to do.
When you became an entrepreneur, how did that happen? And what did your parents and family think about it when you did?
No, so I'm you know, one of the lucky ones. I had fantastic encouragement, and my father for a long time was a mentor. So if you ever ask me, he was the core. At you have to remember, I started the business straight out of college. So I was 23 years old, and I was very naive. You needed a father figure, so I had the father to be my father figure, and he was invaluable for me. Like everyone else, and we've talked, you and I mean, I consider myself an accidental entrepreneur. I wasn't thinking that actually a career could be in building a business. I never knew for a while whether my business that I started was going to survive in the first place. So,
So accidental, but you had but you had somebody supporting you.
Yeah, I had a co-founder. I had a partner who is no longer with us now, but he was he was a bit older than me, and he was definitely a mentor. He and the idea came originally from him, to be fair. So I'm the execution. I executed. I built the business. He was based in New York. I was based in Amman, Jordan, and we thought that we wanted to build the Federal Express of the Middle East. There was a gap in the market. Post offices were lousy. They still are. There was one big multinational, and we thought we were crazy enough to build a company that's going to compete with DHL. Imagine. I mean, even now, if you say it, they think you're crazy. Imagine back in 1983 what people would have said about that. But that takes naivete. That takes somebody that says, well, why not? You know, so it can be done, and you just go out and do it.
So let's talk about the Middle East. You are from Jordan, and you now live in Dubai.
So I built the business out of Jordan. I grew up in Jordan. And I moved only 10 years ago to Dubai for the venture fund and for building the business.
So is it possible to make a comparison about starting a company in the Middle East versus doing it in California or Western Europe?
I tell people who are, whoever wants to listen, that building a business out of Silicon Valley is easy. Yes. Because you are in Silicon Valley.
Right.
So it's you have an idea, you have massive amounts of capital, the infrastructure is practically built. It's an open market. You have a $350 million market, the biggest economy in the world. And it's all open. You don't worry about geography. You don't worry about what do I do to sell a product in from California to New York? How do I access markets? How do I access clients? It's been done before. You have mentors that have done it right next door to you within, 5, 10, 20-mile radius. In the Middle East, we're 22 countries.
Yes.
We're 350 million people
in the
economy,
Middle East.
But 22 countries. Each country has a different regulation, different way of doing business, different way of accessing markets. It is so much more difficult. And you know, these are real heroes and real entrepreneurs, because they go out and they are crashing and demolishing barriers day in and day out. And not waiting for anyone to actually open these doors for them, because it is so difficult. So, yes, it's different. It's different here in Europe also, because you also have a relative, even though you have many countries, but you have a relatively sometimes common regime of a regulatory environment that, and it takes much longer to scale businesses in the Middle East, because you have to struggle with all these multinational boundaries that you have to face. So when I built Aramex, which is a logistics business, and by definition you have to be in many countries, when we were able to conquer the geography of 15 of 22 countries, we effectively made that market suddenly melt and looked like a 350 million people market and a $2 trillion economy. And that's how we became a dominant player, because we made the geography irrelevant at the end of the day.
Right. And now Aramex has revenues of nearly $2 billion.
It's $1.4 billion.
Yeah.
It's we took it public on NASDAQ. We were the first company to have gone ever public from our region on NASDAQ in 1997. And then I bought it back, like every entrepreneur, 5 years later. And then I relisted it again. So I took it. I'm one of the few entrepreneurs that took the same company public twice. We
Good
did
job.
It on the Dubai Stock Exchange. And we actually made 7 times our money within 3 years by taking it from NASDAQ back to Dubai. And I remained a shareholder all the way through, by the way. So buying it back and relisting it again. Talking about exits, because everybody thinks of exits. It took me 35 years to exit my business. So it's you can build a business, you can stick around in it, and you can enjoy doing whatever you're enjoying, and you can create wealth while sticking in the business. There's nothing wrong with thinking long-term and building an 18,000 people company and enjoy running it and creating intrapreneurship inside the organization.
I'll give you a high five for that.
Indeed.
So... a company that wants to establish business in the Middle East or sell to the Middle East,
right.
I know we shouldn't generalize, but what's the general advice?
Talk to me.
Okay.
No, I mean, the general advice is it depends on the market you're going to. And then, again, you know, generalizing means when you say Middle East, you're generalizing. So people that want to come to the Middle East normally come to the Gulf Cooperation Council, so Saudi Arabia, United Arab Emirates, Kuwait, Oman, Bahrain. These are relatively a common market. They look the same. Their currencies are the same practically. They're about 60-70% of the economy of the whole Middle East. So instead of thinking fragmentation of 22 countries, you think of 5-6 countries. You base yourself out of Dubai, and you launch. Dubai is the hub of business and commerce out of the region. So people come and set up there. There is a regulatory regime that allows you to own 100% of your business. It's tax-free. And it allows you to cross border, not only into the Gulf countries. There are a lot of people that are based out of Dubai that do business in Africa, do business in South Asia. Right. It's within a radius of, I'd say, five hours flight. You're tapping into 3-4 billion people market out of Dubai. So, and that's how the city positions itself as.
How is the attitude among buyers if you come there as a Northern European startup with different background, different culture, values? Are they protective, you know, or welcoming?
You know, it's the world, the internet technology has melted that cultural differentiation. So everyone has a smartphone in the region. Everybody transacts. Everybody is on Facebook. Everybody is on Twitter. Everybody consumes massive amounts of YouTube. e-commerce is happening and happening rapidly. So if I'm going to analyze the Middle East with and removing that it is in the Middle East because everybody is scared, Middle East bombs, political upheaval, forget that. Don't believe CNN when you watch it about our region.
Yeah.
We have a different region. It's young. 60% of the population is under the age of 25, and they're all connected, and they're all in tune with what's happening with the rest of the world. So focus on that. Focus on the promise. Focus on the future. Focus on people that look like you, that want to do things. So buying habits are not necessarily different. People might want to do stuff in their own language, in Arabic, but it's the same story. It's Amazon, Google, Facebook, they all have massive operations out of Dubai, by the way. So
talking about the same language and the audience here wants to hear you talk about leadership and values.
Right.
So
leadership, values, culture, the culture of the organization.
How do you think about values in organization? What do you look for?
You need to, and we've talked, you and I, several times before about you know, the issue of values is startups, even at the very early stage, you need to think about what sort of an organization are you building, what sort of culture inside the organization, how do you talk to each other, what is the communication between people, are you creating a flat organization where there is a democratic process, a relatively democratic process of sharing knowledge and sharing capabilities, how do you actually talk to your clients, are you customer-centric, and what does that mean? Do you talk about it, do you address these issues, how do you want the world to view you? And specifically now, look at Silicon Valley from being, and with all due respect, we can go controversial a little bit, and from being the darling of the world to being a sort of in a strange place now. Are we disrupting democracy? What is social media doing to us? Who is manipulating social media? Fake news. And this is all part of an internal process for very powerful companies that wanted to tell us that they had a fantastic corporate culture, but then discover that they have challenges inside that need to be addressed. So every startup needs to realize that this is a complex world, everybody's watching, and you need to be very clear on how you want to manage your organization. Not to talk about harassment and sexual harassment. I mean, this is all, it's part of the process of power. You're the founder, you're a CEO, you feel you can do stuff. People watch you, and the news kill you. Because if you disrupt that process of respect inside the organization, whether for women, males, or females, etc., then that reflects on the whole organization. And some organizations collapse because the CEO failed in translating his real vision of what an organization he's building and his personal actions. Yeah. When you have to walk the walk,
yeah,
and talk the talk, and be there all the time. It is a very, very tough job to be a CEO of a company. It is. There's no glamour in it. No. You are being watched, and you'd better be careful.
So when you were CEO, did you bring up culture and values as a separate topic? Yeah, did you say, let's discuss
My job as a CEO was a preacher. I understood. Yes, I preached. I was in the business of flying all over the world because we were in multinational, we were in 65, 70 countries.
Yeah.
So by definition, multinational, multicultural. So India, UK, US, China. These are different types of people, and the culture unites.
Yeah.
The culture of the organization unites. I was the culture custodian. So I was the preacher, and I felt that culture actually was a differentiator for us from our competition. Because if you ask me today, what the heck did you do building a business competing with DHL? What's the difference? Yeah. What's the difference? I can tell you all sorts of things. We were less expensive stuff. But what really trumped us was a corporate culture was completely flat. I wasn't the guru of gurus up there where everybody comes back to me, hey, boss, what do you think of this? What do you think of that? If people told me, hey, boss, what do you think of that? And they're based in China, they are out of a job. Because I have no idea what happens in China. Okay, you're on the market. You're on the front line. Go fix your problem. You're empowered. It's decentralized. Yeah. It is your story, not mine. I'm only a conductor.
We are running out of time, but we have an important question to you.
Yes.
Teach us something from your culture, some saying or wisdom or something that we can take away from Jordan, from
the Arab world. It's called. You gave me a hint before, so I prepared myself for it, and so that it fits into the startup world. It says I'll say it in Arabic.
Yep.
It sounds like Finnish, by the way. So.
Oh, cool.
Al-mashura liqahu al-uqul. Al-mashura. So seeking advice is the fertilization of the mind.
Ooh.
Seeking advice, have to seek.
Yes.
So you have to ask for advice, and it's how you fertilize your mind. So it's about mentorship, it's about companionship, it is about doing things together, because my mind is better when I ask you questions, and your mind is better when I ask you questions in return.
Wonderful. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.